Good morning and welcome. It is good to be here this morning. It's good to see everyone. We had a wonderful turnout this morning for the Joy Breakfast, and I want to say a special thank you to all who were involved in decorating and getting the food here and serving that. It was very, very pleasant. We really enjoyed it. In fact, I didn't even want to say anything about stopping the fellowship. It was so good to see everybody getting a chance to spend time together and visit. If you happen to make it in here this morning without picking up your Lord's Supper communion cup, if you'd hold your hand up now, we'll make sure and get somebody to you to get that to you, if you just might happen to have missed it. I know that many of you are concerned and prayerful about the victims of the tornadoes that happened yesterday. Just destruction kind of beyond the ability to comprehend. We will be doing something on that. We'll be letting you know soon on what we'll be doing there, but we will do what we can to help those folks out. At this time, let's go to God in prayer. Father, it is so good to be here this morning. We thank you that we have this opportunity to do so. Bless us as we worship. We're mindful, Father, of all of those who were affected by the storms, for those families that lost loved ones, for all who lost their homes and their possessions. We just ask that you would bless them and provide the things that they need. Help all of us as a brotherhood to reach out to them to make a difference in their lives right now because they are struggling mightily. For those that are first responders and those who will be helping with the cleanup, we pray for your protection and blessing to be upon them as well. Now as we enter into this time of worship, we just pray that you'd help us, Father, to focus on you, to focus on the words of the songs that we sing, and to focus on the message that Mark brings to us, that we would be drawn closer to you and know you a little better for having been here this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Bow with me, please. Our Father in heaven, we come to you thanking you for everything, especially thanking you for your Son and our Savior. Father, we come to you with the sick on our minds. I ask you to be with Ron Swofford and Jimmy Webb, Freddie McDonald, Violet Mingy, Travis Irwin, Cindy Jestrap, and I'm sure there are more that covet our prayers and ask for your healing upon them. Father, this devastating tornado that came through and has affected so many lives, Father, we pray for them. Our government can do a great deal to help them, but our government can't pray. And I pray, Father, that you will guide those searching hands to find the survivors, that you'll comfort the injured, comfort those families that have lost loved ones. I pray, Father, that each one of us will take time to ask you to pray to you for all these victims. This is my prayer in Christ's name. Amen.
Let's stand while we sing these next two songs, please.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth.
Thank you.
come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant, O come ye, O come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. O come, let us adore him, O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Sing choirs of angels, sing in exultation, O sing.
This morning's scripture reading will come from Luke chapter 1, verses 67 to 79. And his father Zacharias was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, saying, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited us and accomplished redemption for his people, and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of David his servant, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy toward our fathers and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he swore to Abraham our father, to grant us that we, being rescued from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go on before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give his people the knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of their sins, because of the tender mercy of our God, with which the sunrise from on high will visit us, to shine upon those who sit in darkness and the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace."
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jake. If you haven't opened your Bible yet to the text, go ahead and be opening it to Luke chapter 1. And while you're opening it, hold it up at the same time. If you've got your Bible, go ahead and hold it up. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Now you can put your marker in Luke chapter 1. Good to see all of you this morning. If you're our guest today, we are grateful for your presence with us, and we hope you'll come back and be with us whenever you can. If you are visiting with us today, I would encourage you, if you don't mind, to take a yellow card on the back of the pew in front of you, and if you would just fill that out and leave that there in your pew where you're sitting, we would appreciate that very, very much. Some of you are joining us by way of our live stream today. We're grateful that you are participating in worship with us today as well. If you would, let us know down in the comments that you're here. And if you are from outside of our area, if you don't mind letting us know where you are participating from this morning, we would love to know that as well. Many of you may know the name Isaac Watts. Isaac Watts was a genius. By the age of 4, he was fluent in Latin. By the time he was 9, he was fluent in Greek. By the time he was 11, he was fluent in French. By the time he was 13 years old, Isaac Watts was fluent in Hebrew. He's a genius. Probably Isaac Watts is best known for his taking the Psalms and reworking them. They're already poetic. It's already poetic language. But he took the Psalms and he reworked them into his own poetry. But unfortunately for poor Isaac, evidently, he wasn't much to look at. And so Isaac Watts was single his entire life. He had one shot at love, and that was through a lady named Elizabeth Singer. It was kind of an amazing story. Elizabeth Singer fell in love with Isaac Watts, sight unseen, just from reading his poetry. She fell in love with him. She was even so bold that she proposed marriage to Isaac, having never even seen him. She wrote him a letter and proposed marriage to him. Can you imagine that? Well, they were excited. You know, Isaac's excited. Elizabeth is excited until she met Isaac. And then she retracted her offer. Evidently, his Facebook profile picture did not match what he looked like in person. And so she saw him and she retracted her offer. Listen to what Elizabeth Singer said. Okay, this is what she said about Isaac. Only 5 feet tall, with a shallow face, hooked nose, prominent cheekbones, small eyes, and death-like color. I admired the jewel, she said, but not the casket it contained. Wow. Don't you feel a little sorry for poor Isaac Watts, right? Isaac never married, but he spent his entire life focused on the glory of God. And in 1719, Isaac Watts published his poetic work based on Psalm 98. And in the minds of many people, it would go down as one of the greatest Christmas hymns of all time. Maybe you've heard it. It's called Joy to the World. If that's your favorite hymn around this time of the year or any other time of the year, you can thank that 5 feet tall guy with death-like color because he's the one that wrote it, right? Christmas is just a time that's filled with song. There are a lot of melodies and lyrics during this time of year that are so familiar to us that just highlight the season. But our sermon series in the month of December, I'm calling Songs of the Season, but it's not about those songs. There are actually 4 songs in the New Testament that are connected with the coming of Jesus into our world. Last week, we looked at Mary's song here in Luke chapter 1. And this morning, we're again here in Luke 1, and we're focusing on another one of these 4 songs. And this one is Zechariah's song. You say, who is Zechariah? Zechariah was the father of John the Baptist. And we'll say more about that as we go through this morning. But what I want you to see from Zechariah's song is this. This is the lesson we learn from this song. If you don't remember anything else I say, please remember this one. God keeps his word. That's what Zechariah is singing about in this song, that God keeps his word. Zechariah was a priest, ironically, married to a lady named Elizabeth. God had promised Zechariah and Elizabeth that in their old age, they were going to have a baby. Zechariah didn't believe it. Zechariah looked at the angel who told him that, and in essence, you know, he said, hey, look, I'm a card-carrying member of the AARP. I'm already drawing my Social Security check. There is no way I'm going to believe we're having a baby in our old age. You gotta give me a definitive sign. The angel said, okay, Zechariah, here's your sign. For the entire 9 months of your wife's pregnancy, you're not going to be able to speak a word. And God miraculously shut his mouth. Now, some of you ladies are thinking, man, it would have been nice if my husband hadn't said anything for the whole 9 months that I was pregnant. I know what some of y'all are thinking, but this was a miraculous thing. God shut his mouth. He could not speak for 9 months. Imagine that. And then when he finally can speak, after his son John is born to him and Elizabeth, the first thing he says are the words of our text that we're reading this morning. The first thing he does is he sings this song. He utters a word of praise and prophecy and promise. The lyrics of this song are remarkable, and they remind us, as God's people, that God keeps his word, that God fulfills his promise, that God has come to redeem his people, that God is good, and that God is faithful. So let's dive into Zechariah's song this morning. The first thing I want you to notice in it is this. Regarding God keeping his word, Zechariah says that he has redeemed his people. We see that in verses 67 through 75. One of the themes of the coming of the Messiah is the redemption of the people of God, that we have been redeemed and we have been set free. Now think about this for a moment. Socrates taught for some 40 years, and his teaching, as far as I know, never inspired anybody to write a song. Plato taught for some 50 years. I don't remember hearing any songs about Plato. Jesus lived for 33 years, and for three of those years, he taught on this earth. And yet, and from his teaching and his person and his promise and his power, you think of people like Michelangelo and Raphael and Leonardo. That's the other one I was trying to think of and ran them together. Leonardo da Vinci. You think of Handel's Messiah. You think of Mendelssohn and the music of people like this. All of these people found their inspiration to give us what they gave us in Jesus. He changes everything. And that's certainly what happened with Zechariah. Here he is in disbelief. You're going to have a son, you and your wife are, and he's going to be a prophet. He's going to be the forerunner of the Messiah. And Zechariah says, I don't believe it. God strikes him silent for 9 months, and then he begins to proclaim the goodness and the faithfulness of God. I think it's interesting. The very first thing Zechariah does when he can speak again is he sings. And he sings about how God has redeemed his people, about how God has kept his word. Look at what he says in verse 67. And his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, saying, Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David. Look at those words. He has visited us. The word became flesh and dwelt among us, right? He visited us and he has redeemed us. You know what that word redeemed means? It means to set free by the payment of a price. And so Zechariah says, God has come to set us free. God has come in the person of Jesus who would be born. God has come in order to pay the price to redeem us and to ransom us. It's a word that can refer to the release of a prisoner or the liberation of a slave. Jesus Christ came to bring deliverance to those who were captive, so that those who are held captive in the kingdom of darkness can be transferred into the kingdom of his marvelous light, that our chains can be broken because of the grace of God. He has redeemed us. And then look at what else Zechariah says in that verse. He has redeemed us, and he has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of David. I'm going to come back to that house of David part in a minute. But look at that phrase, horn of salvation. That's not a phrase we ever use, is it? Nobody goes around talking about horns of salvation. But you'll find that phrase in the Bible a lot. So what does it mean? A horn of salvation refers to strength and might and power and victory. You'll see it throughout the Old Testament especially. Here it's referring to the strength and the power and the might and the victory that is offered to us through the Lord Jesus Christ. That God, in his redemption, not only sets us free, but he also gives us the power for our enemies to be defeated. The picture of redemption is the captives are set free. The picture of the horn of salvation is that the enemy is defeated. The captives are free and the battle is won. That's what God has done for us in Jesus Christ. Death and hell and the grave were defeated in Jesus. We can be set free and we can be on the winning side if we follow Him. That's what God has done for us this morning in Jesus. He's redeemed His people. He's kept His word. Dr. E.T. Sullivan said this. He said, the greatest forces in the world are not the earthquakes and the thunderbolts. The greatest forces in the world are babies. Think about that. When you have a baby, it changes things, doesn't it? And any of you that have ever had a baby are going, mm-hmm. Jessica's back there thinking, this week, there's another one coming. Tater, it's going to change things a little bit for y'all this week. By the way, be praying for Jessica and Tater this week. Wednesday is her induction day, and hopefully this new baby is going to be born into this world very, very soon. So be praying for that. Babies change things. But no baby's ever changed things like Jesus did. Jesus changes everything. And what I long for more than anyone, more than anything else, is to see the light come on in someone's life when they see the truth of that, the truth of what we're talking about this morning from their for themselves, and they're able to proclaim like Zechariah, God has redeemed me. God has set me free. God has defeated sin and death and hell. God has ransomed me and redeemed me, and I'm going to rejoice and give Him praise. That's what happens when we recognize God is a God who fulfills His word and keeps His promise. He has redeemed His people. My question to you this morning, and I'm going to circle back to it at the end, can you sing the song of the redeemed this morning? Not only does the Bible tell us in this song that God has redeemed His people, but He also tells us God has fulfilled His promise. We see this in verses 76 through 79. In Jesus, God's promises are fulfilled. I mentioned that phrase, House of David, earlier. Remember that? Where God's going to raise up this horn of salvation for us in the house of David. That's pointing back to what the Old Testament said about the Messiah. That the Christ would be from the lineage of David. That David would be his ancestor. And if you look at Mary and Joseph's lineage, guess who's in it? David is there, right? God kept His promise. God fulfilled His word. Notice in verse 76, as God fulfills His promise, our prayers are answered. Zechariah sings in this song about his son John that's going to be born to him and Elizabeth. And look at what he says. He says, and you, child, he's talking to his child, this new baby that he's holding in his arms, John. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare His ways. I want you to think about the context of this. If you are Zechariah, if you're Elizabeth, if you're Mary, and if you're Joseph, for 400 years, there has been no prophetic word from God. There has been nothing. When you look in your Bible, maybe between Malachi and Matthew, maybe you've got a couple of pages. Those two pages represent 400 years of history where there was no prophetic word from God. There was just silence. And so there's all sorts of wondering and there's all sorts of wishing and hoping and praying that the Messiah would come, that hope would come, that light would come. And then one day, an angel speaks to a young girl named Mary. An angel speaks to a young man named Joseph. An angel speaks to Zechariah and Elizabeth and says that your boy is going to be a forerunner of the Messiah. He's going to be a voice crying in the wilderness that prepares the way for the Lord. That's John the Baptist, right? That's the one that the Old Testament predicted would come. Back in Malachi, there it is, Malachi 3 and verse 1. God said, behold, I send my messenger. He will prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come into His temple. And the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight. Behold, He's coming, says the Lord of hosts. He said that in Malachi. For 400 years there was nothing except silence. And now, John is born, Who's this prophesying would come? This is John the Baptist. This is the one who would be the forerunner of the Lord Jesus. It's interesting as Zechariah looks at this little baby boy that he holds in his arms, and when he can finally speak again, he reminds us, God answers prayer. They've been praying for 400 years that this would happen. God answers prayer. Might not be in our time. Might not be on our calendar. Might not be what we would expect. Listen, might not even be in the way we would want. But God answers prayers according to His will and His purpose for His glory. As God fulfills His promise, not only are our prayers answered, but Zechariah also sings about our sins being forgiven. Look in verse 77. This is what John's mission would be. This baby that he's holding in his arms, this is what his mission would be. To give knowledge of salvation to his people in the forgiveness of their sins. And John, in his uncompromising message, did that, didn't he? Because over and over again, he would say to the people, repent, right? For the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The word forgiveness here means to send away. It means to dismiss a debt. Here's the reality. All of us are in debt to God because of our sin. If we're old enough to know what sin is, we're in debt to God because of our sin. We've broken His commandments. We've broken His law. You say, I don't owe a debt to God. You do. You don't, may not know you do, but you do. And here's the thing. We're incapable on our own of paying that debt. There's nothing that we can do in and of ourselves to pay it. But what Zechariah is singing is that through the coming of John, as he prepares the way for Jesus as the Messiah, our sin debt is paid. Jesus pays a debt He doesn't owe. It's a debt that we owe. He pays it for us. In love, He redeems us. And He pays that price to purchase our redemption. Our prayers are answered as God fulfills His word. Our sins are forgiven as God fulfills His promise. And then look at this third thing. As God fulfills His promise, our lives are transformed. We're not the same anymore. Darkness gives way to light. Look in verse 78. Zechariah sings, because of the tender mercy of our God, whereby the sunrise shall visit us from on high, to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. John is using an image here to make a point. He's using the image of Israel, the nation of Israel, as this large caravan that's wandering through the desert, but they're wandering in the darkness. The dark has set in. And he's using that darkness to illustrate what it's like before Jesus comes into the world. What it's like before Jesus comes into our lives. Can you just imagine, just picture it. You're out in this vast caravan among the Israelites. You're there wandering in the desert. You're there with your spouse maybe and your kids, and they're there with you. And you're groping in the dark because you can't see. And you're hoping that maybe the light would come and maybe the darkness would lift. And then just when you think all hope might be lost, you look at the eastern horizon. I don't know which way east is, y'all, so don't expect me to point in the right direction. It's somewhere, all right? You look on the eastern horizon, and all of a sudden, the darkness of night turns into a little bit more like navy blue. And then all of a sudden, you see the sunrise come, and the light comes, right? And it seems like now hope is restored and our lives are changed and joy is fulfilled because the God who promised that the light would come has delivered on His promise and He's come. That's exactly how the people of God, Israel, are pictured here. They're pictured wandering in the darkness, but in the darkness, Zechariah says, the sunrise, you see that? The sunrise shall visit us from on high. To give light to those in the darkness and in the shadow of death. To guide our feet into the way of peace. It's interesting, the word sunrise here. It translates an old English word, day spring. Maybe some of the translations even have day spring in it. It's rendered different ways, but it's just talking about the day springing up. the sun rising, the morning sun. But listen, this is not talking about that great big ball of fire in the sky. This is not talking about the S-U-N. John's talking, or Zechariah here is talking about the S-O-N. He's talking about the Son of Righteousness. He's talking about the one that we sang this morning who rises with healing in His wings. He's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ who brings light into the darkness and into our lives and transforms them. Malachi 4 and verse 2 talks about the Son of Righteousness who rises with healing in His wings. 2 Peter 1 verse 19 says, Jesus is the morning star who rises in our hearts. Revelation 22, He's the offspring of David, the bright and morning star. Jesus says of Himself that I am the light of the world. Whoever follows Me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Those who walked in darkness have seen a great light, the Bible says, because He is the light of the world. And so Zechariah sings that when the sunrise visits us, the shadow of death disappears. Do you see that in the verse? The shadows of death disappear. Here are people separated from God. Here are people sitting in darkness, living under the shadow of death. But when the light comes, the darkness and the shadows disappear. He comes to guide our feet, Zechariah says, into the way of peace. Listen, this is no ordinary light that Zechariah is singing about. Those who experience the healing wholeness of the peace of God. You know, it says in one place, I love this image. It says in one place in Scripture that they're going to be like the young calf that's released from the stall. Can you imagine that? This young calf has been pent up in this stall, and all of a sudden the door, the gate to the stall is opened. And this calf, y'all ever seen a calf? Man, this calf just goes running and jumping and leaping because, you know, he's been set free. That's us. That's what Zechariah is singing about in this song. That is us. Those of us who've been in bondage have had the doors of forgiveness flown wide open because of Jesus. The darkness is gone. The chains are broken. And we rejoice in the light that we found. I wonder this morning, has the sunrise from on high filled your life? Are you assured of the forgiveness of your sin? Have you been delivered from the shadow of death? Are your feet guided in the pathway of peace? If not, you know what you need this morning? You need a sunrise. That's a pretty sunrise out there. You know, I'm not talking about that. You need an S-O-N-R-I-S-E. You need a sunrise in your life. You may feel like the darkness surrounds you and you don't know which way to go. You need the Son of Righteousness in your life. You need to know and follow Jesus. So here's Zechariah, his old priest. He hadn't said anything for 9 months, but boy, he makes up for it when he opens his mouth, doesn't he? God calls us today to believe His good news. And for those of us who believe and embrace His good news, we can rejoice. We too can sing the song of a father who's holding his son as he thinks about the seismic shift that's coming into the world. Nothing like this has ever happened before. And so Zechariah had to sing. He had to proclaim the goodness of God. And so do we. But please don't miss the point of Zechariah's song. That God has visited us in the person of Jesus Christ. And today that same divine visitor comes to your life, and you got to make a choice. Do you have the light in your life? Will you, like Zechariah, drop everything and welcome Him in? Or are you too busy to bother with Jesus? Or maybe you love the darkness too much to really long for the light. I want you to know this morning, friends, God keeps His word. Every promise that He has ever made either has been or one day will be fulfilled. And even though we have moments where we, like those people, felt like God was silent and we felt like we were in darkness, according to His timetable and His purposes, He moves. And when He moves, light comes. Maybe this morning what you need more than anything else is that light in your life. One of our shepherds is going to be standing down front here in just a moment when we sing what we call our song of invitation. It's a song that invites you to think about your greatest spiritual need and to respond to that. Maybe for some of you this morning, your greatest spiritual need is to know and follow Jesus so that His light can rise, the sunrise can rise in your life today. We'd love to help you to do that today. Maybe your life as a follower of Jesus is just a little bit dark right now, and you need to be reminded of the sun, not just the S-U-N, the S-O-N. We'd love to pray with you today and help you any way that we possibly can. If you're watching on our live stream and you have a spiritual need, go to the private message. Send us a message. We'll do what we can to reach out to you this week and help you. Let's stand together and let's worship God. You come as you need to this morning while we stand and worship together.
My only hope is You, Jesus. My only hope is You. From early in the morning till late at night, my only hope is You. My only peace is You, Jesus.
Be seated, please. As we begin to think about the Lord's Supper, we'll sing "In Christ Alone."
Thank you.
just going to read this morning from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 22, and just a few verses starting with 14. It says, "When the hour had come, he reclined at the table, and the apostles with him. And he said to them, 'I've earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I shall never again eat it until it's fulfilled in the kingdom of God.'" And I'm going to skip down to verse 19. "When he had taken some bread and given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, 'This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" If you would, bow your heads with me. God in heaven, we are gathered here today with one of the prime purposes of remembering the sacrifice that your Son made for us, taking the entire sin of the world on him, bearing all the pain, feeling you turn from him because you couldn't stand the sight of our sins. But God, thank you so much for that sacrifice. Thank you for this weekly ceremony that you established so that it will help us remember. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Read in verse 20. "In the same way he took the cup after they had eaten, saying, 'This cup which is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood.'" If you bow your heads again. God in heaven, thank you for this new covenant that you've made with us, that we've got the possibility of coming to live with you forever in heaven. God, help us to remember the sacrifice and the blood with which that contract was written. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Just a few things regarding our church family here that we want to make you aware of and remind you of before we are dismissed today. Let me add my thanks to all who were involved in our worship committee in planning the Joy Breakfast this morning. There was a lot of joy in the breakfast, not just the good food, but great fellowship and a great time this morning. Thank you all for planning that. Families with young children, this announcement is especially for you. We're looking for families with young children who are willing to put together a small craft and to deliver that to our shut-ins during the holiday season. We will supply for you all of the things that you need for this craft. In fact, they will be supplied and will be available to pick up next Sunday. This is a craft that's simple enough, even I could do it. The way we worded it was, it's simple enough for a two-year-old. But I thought I would just say, it's simple enough even that I could do this. So anybody in your family, you think, well, they're too young. No, they can do this craft. If you are interested in doing that, they will be available to pick up next Sunday. If you want to help with that, please see Sarah Holmes or Becca Pitney and let them know that you are interested and want to help with that. Our seniors' holiday party is this coming Friday, the 17th, from 4 until 6. If you are interested in coming to that, I'm going to let you determine whether you are a senior or not. That's kind of a flexible term. You may qualify. You may not think you do, but you just might qualify for that. If you're interested in coming to that, there is a sign-up sheet. Please sign up today if you possibly can. If you're planning on coming to that, please bring a side dish or a dessert. Our rooted groups are meeting tonight, so hopefully if you're in one of those groups, you have heard from your group leader and about the plan for tonight. I will say our teen group, I think, is meeting here at the building. Is that correct? At 5 o'clock. Tonight is your gingerbread project. Y'all know what that is, and y'all know what that means, so come prepared to win, right? Come to win tonight, y'all. That's tonight, 5 o'clock, for our teen group. All the other groups will be meeting as they usually are as well. I want to go ahead and mention this. Of course, the last couple of years has been different in some of the things we've had to adjust to. And one of those things is we stopped having our greeters out front because, for obvious reasons, that probably wasn't a good thing to have. We want to start having our greeters again. Several reasons behind that, not the least of which is, isn't it great when you walk into a place for the first time as a guest to have somebody standing there to welcome you with a smile, to put a bulletin in your hand, to answer your questions, to show you where the restrooms are, to show you where the classrooms are, to take you where you need to go if necessary, to hand you your communion or to point out where the communion is. That's one we didn't have to worry about 2 years ago, right? Now we got to think about that. And so we want to start having our greeters again. Starting in January. There is a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board down this way by the office, where it used to be. If you don't know where that is, it's down here by the office. We're going to try to do one greeter a week rather than two and see how that goes. We've got the whole year up there. Pick a week, sign up for any week that you want to help with that. You say, I don't know how to be a greeter. It really isn't complicated. Smile, welcome people, and help them go and find what they need to find. If you can't do it, find somebody. There's plenty of us standing out there. We'll be glad to take them where they need to go and point them where they need to go. You just greet them with a smile, show them the bulletin, show them communion, and welcome them here. That's what we want to try to get back into doing. So if you're interested in that, please sign up for that. If you're a part of our church family and haven't had an opportunity to yet, there is a basket on the table in the foyer for you to place your contribution in. There's also an empty trash can in the foyer for you to place your an empty trash can. There's a trash can in the foyer for you to place your empty communion cup in. So please do that as you leave today. Let's bow together as we're dismissed. Father, we are so grateful to you for the blessing it has been to be together with your people to worship you this morning. God, we pray that you have indeed been magnified and exalted by our worship today. And I pray, Father, as we leave this place and go into our world this week, that we will take that worship with us and let it transform the way we live this week. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Y'all have a blessed week.